Good morning. My name is Lindsay Newton, and I work with education and community engagement at the Missouri Historical Society. And on behalf of MHS, I want to welcome you to STL History Live. Thank you for joining us virtually today. I'll just mention that while we continue to have some virtual programs, we are also excited to welcome visitors back to our beautiful spaces with several safety precautions in place. And we would love for you to visit if you feel safe. The Missouri History Museum in Forest Park is open every day except Monday. And starting this week, we are open until 8 p.m. on Thursday evenings. I will quickly mention a few details about how today's program will run. This will be a roughly 40-minute presentation, followed by 10 to 15 minutes of Q&A and panelist discussion. And the best way to ask a question is to type your question in using the Q&A button in your toolbar, and you can do that at any time. Today's presentation is being recorded, so if you'd like to view it again or share it with folks who maybe couldn't make it this morning, it will soon be posted on our MHS YouTube channel. And lastly, your feedback is always important to us. It helps us plan for the future, so we'd really appreciate if you could answer a few questions after the program. A survey will pop up in another tab on your browser. And before we get started, some thank yous. I know that some of you watching today are members of MHS, and your support makes so much of our work possible. I also want to acknowledge the support from the Zoom Museum Tax District. Also, big thank you to the museum's Latinx Community Engagement Advisory Committee, and also the Puerto Rican Society in St. Louis. Several individuals from these groups collaborated to put together today's important conversation. This year, 2021, marks the 200th anniversary of Missouri becoming part of the United States. And before becoming a state, Missouri was a territory of the US. Today, more than two centuries after Missouri's path from territory led to statehood, the island of Puerto Rico is currently a US territory. So thank you again for joining us for a conversation about Puerto Rico's status in the US. At this time, it is my pleasure to introduce you to our moderator, Daniela Velázquez, who is on screen with me, and she in turn is going to introduce our presenters. Daniela provides an integrated perspective for clients on media relations, communication strategy, diversity, equity, and inclusion communication and social impact at St. Louis-based global public relations firm Fleischmann Hillard. Previously, Daniela managed accounts for a St. Louis-based boutique agency in the utilities, public health, and theater spaces. Before moving to the agency world, Daniela worked as a director of communications for the American Civil Liberties Union, or ACLU, of Missouri. And in prior roles, Daniela spent time as a consultant for the Ferguson Commission and supported the St. Louis Mosaic Project. Daniela honed her communication skills while covering news in Florida, and she is a proud member of the Puerto Rican Society of St. Louis. When she's not working, you can usually find her exploring the outdoors on a hiking trail, writing about her travel adventures, or watching telenovelas. So at this time, Daniela, I'm going to hand it off to you. Thank you so much for being here with us.
Great. Thank you, Lindsay. And thank you all for joining us today, this afternoon. And as Lindsay mentioned, 200 years ago, Missouri was a territory. So what did this mean for the people who lived here, who wanted to settle here, and how did they see themselves? These are the questions that led us to today's panel. As a commonwealth or territory of the US, Puerto Rico finds itself in what is essentially territorial status. Our panelists today, which I'll introduce shortly, may have other words to describe the current state of affairs, and we'll get to that. Since the United States took control of the island in 1898, Puerto Ricans on and off the island have wrestled with their cultural identity and their political status in the US. Just as Missourians wrestled with what it meant to be neither a state nor a sovereign entity 200 years ago. Puerto Ricans today wrestle with the issue of status and what it means to be Puerto Rican. Today, we will discuss what it means to be in territorial limbo from a historical, political, and cultural point of view. We're joined by three dynamic panelists who will help us examine these issues. Each of our panelists will give an overview from a historical, political, and cultural perspective, and then we'll have a discussion. At the end, as Lindsay mentioned, we'll open up the floor, the virtual floor here, for a question and answer session, and you can drop your questions and comments in the chat. So today I'm joined by Omar Eaton-Martinez, the Diversity, Equity, Accessibility, and Inclusion Senior Fellow for the American Alliance of Museums and Head of Historical Resources for Prince George's County Parks and Recreation. Next, we have Luimil Negrón-Pérez, a doctoral candidate and E. Desmond Lee Scholar in Urban Education at the University of Missouri, St. Louis. And finally, we have Fernando Tormos-Aponte, and please, panelists, I'm working on my Spanish, so if I mispronounce your name, please correct it for me and for our audience. And Fernando is an assistant professor of public policy and political science at the University of Maryland, Baltimore County, a Kendall Fellow at the Union of Concerned Scientists, and a visiting scholar at the Johns Hopkins University Department of Political Science. So what we're going to do today is Omar is going to get us started from a historical perspective of the island, and then each of our panelists will give an overview, again, from the historical, political, and cultural perspective, and then we'll open it up. So I'm going to turn the virtual mic over to Omar, and he's going to get us started.
Saludos a todos. Greetings to everyone. Thank you so much for the invitation, Daniela, and to the Missouri Historical Society to participate in this program. I just wanted to start off by saying que yo soy boricua, para que lo sepas. I was born in D.C., raised in Silver Spring, but my parents came over to this part of the United States back in the 60s when my father started his career at NASA and my mother started her career in D.C. public schools. I want to launch in. We got 10 minutes to cover hundreds and hundreds of years of history, so I'm just going to go ahead and launch in, and hopefully if you have questions, we'll get to those at the end. But I think it's fair to start to say that Puerto Rico history did not start when Columbus arrived. You know, there was an existing civilization there of the Taino Nation, and the island back then was called Borinquen. It is now known as one of the oldest colonies, having been under some form of military occupation or protectorate since 1508. We know that Columbus did stop by in 1493 in November. But again, when he arrived, there was nothing to be discovered. There were already people there thriving and doing great things. The indigenous Taino culture dominated the island since the beginning, and there's still remnants of the culture embedded and integrated, and I'm sure fellow panelists will dig into that later in their discussion. I wanted to kind of put into context also by offering up some scholars that hopefully you all can look on your own time, seeing we have such short time together. Jose Luis Gonzalez, who is a Puerto Rican essayist and novelist, university professor. He wrote a book called Puerto Rico, the Four-Story Country and Other Essays, which was first published back in 1980. And one of his assertions that he had in his book was, when the descendants of the first African slaves had already become Black Puerto Ricans, they essentially were the first Puerto Ricans, because the people on the island were Taino, the people that the European settlers were from Spain. And so when the Africans were brought to the island, they were basically the first majority and essentially took on and were the essential Puerto Ricans that we now know as today. Guillermo Baralt is another historian, a Puerto Rican historian who wrote Esclavos Rebeldes, Conspiraciones y Sublevaciones de Esclavos en Puerto Rico, Slave Revolts in Puerto Rico, Slave Conspiracies and Uprising in Puerto Rico. And he documents acts of resistance from 1795 to 1873. And I share that with you because, again, there's an idea of sort of this racial democracy, that there was never anything upsetting on the island, and there was no reason to have racism when we actually have a shared history with the institution of slavery like we do in different parts of the Americas. So there's really no difference in that either. So jumping ahead to the Jones-Shafroth Act of 1917, we know that April 12, 1898, the Spanish War begins. And so now we start to see a transition of sovereignties from Spain to what we now know as the United States. On December 10th of 1898, the Spanish-American War ends, and Puerto Rico, Guam, and Philippines are ceded to the United States, and the Treaty of Paris on December 10, 1898. Puerto Rico was ruled by U.S. military and a governor appointed by the President of the United States during that time. Then in a couple years, the Foraker Act of 1900 ended military rule and provided for a temporary civil government for Puerto Rico. Luis Muñoz Rivera, who had fought with Tulio Larinaga for sovereignty for Puerto Rico since it belonged to Spain, back then argued for citizenship for Puerto Ricans and a civil government before and after the passage of the Foraker Act, which did not provide for citizenship. March 2nd, 1917, we have President Woodrow Wilson signs the Jones-Shafroth Act, making Puerto Rico a U.S. territory. In a couple of months, on May 18th of the same year, Congress passed the Selective Service Act of 1917, which permitted Puerto Ricans to be drafted into the U.S. military service. Woodrow Wilson signs the Jones Act, under which English is decreed the official language of Puerto Rico, and Puerto Ricans are granted United States citizenship. This did enable 18,000 Puerto Ricans to fight in World War I. I know that it's common knowledge for people to evoke that as a reason why citizenship was granted to Puerto Rico, so that they could fight and put their lives on the line. And I think there's definitely some validity to that, but I just wanted to offer another scholar's point of view. Harry Frankie Rivera, an associate professor at Bloomfield College in Jersey, he wrote, a month after the Jones-Shafroth Act was passed, the government of Puerto Rico offered volunteers to the U.S. military, and the offer was declined by the Secretary of War. A month later, when they signed that Selective Service Act of 1917 that I mentioned, and it established the draft, it excluded the territories of Hawaii, Alaska, and Puerto Rico, because these were territories at the time. You know, not two of those three are now states. These facts by themselves should indicate that drafting Puerto Rican soldiers was not the reason for the Jones Act. And of course, there's rebuke and rebuttals to his scholarship as well. But I think it's just fair to kind of show two different sides there. It definitely separated Puerto Rico's government into an executive, judicial, and legislative branch and endowed Puerto Ricans with the Bill of Rights. On June 5th, 1920, we had the Merchant Marine Act that was signed and ensured the country maintained a shipbuilding industry and seafaring labor force. We know that Section 27 of this law decreed that only American ships could carry goods and passengers from one United States port to another. In addition, every ship must be built, crewed, and owned by American citizens. Now, the impact of this is great, and we saw it rear its ugly head during the tragedies of Maria and Irma in 2017. One of the studies that was conducted by John Donovan Associates found that the Jones Act has prevented the creation of 13,250 jobs and $1.5 billion in annual economic growth, representing $1.1 billion in higher prices and $337.3 million in wages and $106.4 million in lost tax revenues. Another study conducted by the Advantage Business Consulting looked specifically at U.S. territories' food industry and estimated that the Jones Act equaled a 7.2% tax on food and beverages alone, or about $367 million extra for island residents. You know, and so there's a lot of things that that we can look at that really continue to underline the colonial status of the island, which doubly or exponentially affected the impact on how Puerto Ricans survived tragedies like Irma, like Maria, like the recent earthquake, and certainly what we're dealing with on the island with COVID-19. And so I'm going to leave it right there, and thank you for your time.
All right, thank you, Omar. And, you know, as a group, I did a quick search of news search on what was happening, you know, in Puerto Rico today. And, you know, there's lots of stuff to talk about when we get when we wrap up this conversation, but certainly there's a Supreme Court ruling, or the Supreme Court refused to take up a case about cockfighting on the island, and certainly it relates to this idea of status. And there's a lot going on with the power company and the mm-hmm. island declaring a state of emergency, which, you know, for our audience, these things may seem disparate, but I think they're actually related to what we're talking about today. So I'm gonna pass it over to Fernando, and he's going to take us through a little bit of the, again, we're trying to get, like Omar said, we're trying to get a few hundred years history here in 40 minutes. So this is like your super sped up TED talk, but he's going to lead us through some of the political history and formation on the island. So Fernando.
Thank you for this great invitation, for this panel. I'm excited to be part of this and to virtually come back to St. Louis, which was a home to me for 2 years, and it was a wonderful home, and I miss my Puerto Rican community there. So thank you for organizing this. So again, there's a lot of history here, and I'll start by saying that there's no way we can cover that in this short period of time, but I do want to give you all a general understanding of what the current political landscape is and what were some of the lasting legacies of the histories that Omar very, very eloquently and described in his portion. So essentially, we know that this Jones-Stafford Act had a lasting legacy, and it enabled movement across borders. So we saw a massive migration of Puerto Ricans into the mainland. It enabled citizenship. Puerto Ricans went from having Puerto Rican citizenship, like that actually existed prior to this act, to having U.S. citizenship. And of course, there's the debate on the extent to which this was granted due to the U.S.'s interest in bringing Puerto Ricans into military service. And that's a huge, huge debate that I think Omar did a great job of capturing. Another thing that this act did was that it created the issuing of bonds as a very important and central mechanism for funding basic social programs and infrastructures of the Puerto Rican government, which Puerto Ricans had a lot of interest in. So economically, the U.S. was able to extract a lot of capital from Puerto Rico from the various industries that it set up there throughout time. And I want to refer folks to the book Puerto Rico in the American Century by Cesar Ayala and Rafael Bernabe, which does a really good job of reviewing this history of the political economy of Puerto Rico. But essentially, the U.S. was extracting all of this capital throughout all of these industries, and there wasn't a plan for economic development that would enable Puerto Rico to sustain itself economically. And instead, it had to issue these bonds that were exempt from federal, state, and local taxes. So bonds and issuing these bonds became a really crucial mechanism for funding the Puerto Rican government. And it is one of the reasons for why now there is this massive debt that Puerto Ricans are under, which then affected its politics, because Puerto Ricans had fiscal autonomy, and that fiscal autonomy was then removed and given to a fiscal oversight board that is appointed by the federal government. Members of Congress in conjunction with the executive branch appoint the members of this fiscal control board that have complete control over the budget. So another thing that this act did, besides sort of defining the Puerto Rican economy for centuries or generations to come, it also defined what politics would look like for generations to come, because recurrently the United States refused to resolve and still refuses to resolve the issue of Puerto Rico's political status, its relationship with the United States, whereby it remains in this sort of limbo of a non-incorporated territory that is known as the Estado Libre Asociado, the freely associated state, a name that has been widely criticized because Puerto Rico is not free, it's not associated, or it is not and it is not a state, right? So this was implemented in 1952, and it was sort of a concession that was given to Puerto Ricans at a time in which support for independence in Puerto Rico was at an all-time high. Not only that, Puerto Ricans had, some of them, taken up armed struggle in pursuit of independence. So there was a lasting legacy of these major pieces of legislation whereby the Puerto Rican politics, that political landscape was organized mostly around status preferences. And now we have major parties that represent their status preferences of Puerto Ricans as opposed to their stances on policy issues outside of status, things like social policies, things like welfare, parties in Puerto Rico are organized around status. So one of these parties is interested in preserving the current status or modifying it slightly. It's the Partido Popular Democrático. Another party is in support of statehood, the Partido Nuevo Progresista. And there's a party that supports independence, the Partido Independentista Puerto Riqueño. And I'll come back to the parties because there's been some recent developments with respect to the formation of new parties. But before we get there, it's important to say that Puerto Ricans have only been ruled by two major parties, the party that is in favor of statehood and the party that is in favor of the current status or a modified version of it, Partido Nuevo Progresista and Partido Popular Democrático. One of the reasons, so there's a lot of debate on why the statehood party has managed to garner so much support. It has become one of the strongest political forces in Puerto Rico. So there are two main explanations for this. One is that ideologically, the idea of statehood is compelling to a lot of folks. So there are major arguments that are forwarded in support of statehood for Puerto Rico, one of which is that Puerto Rico is too dependent on the metropolis, on the United States economically, and it is impossible to develop an independent and self-sustainable economy in Puerto Rico that could support its population. That idea has also propelled this fear of what Puerto Rico would be without the United States, if it were independent. And it is usually a very racialized sort of discourse that tends to compare Puerto Rico with the darkest corners of the world. That's what Puerto Rico would look like. Puerto Rico would be Haiti. Puerto Rico would be Cuba. Puerto Rico would be Venezuela. And this is the kind of fear that is used to promote ideologically support for statehood, although there are also progressive discourses that are used in support of statehood, folks who believe that it is possible to achieve democracy under the United States and to push the United States into being a more democratic country by making Puerto Rico a state, as well as by recognizing the civil rights and liberties of communities in the United States that continue to be excluded from its political system and oppressed. So another thing that props up and that makes the statehood party so strong is more, a more sociological understanding, is the fact that the pro-statehood party has formed a really strong party structure. They have been able to form local parties in each municipality. There are 78 municipalities in Puerto Rico, and they're able to, every 4 years, get out the vote. They canvass a lot of people. And through this local party organizational structure, they're able to promote these ideas of the benefits of statehood. And they actually managed to garner a lot of votes, enough at least, to continue to win elections. And it's important to understand that in Puerto Rico, there's been a tradition of high voter turnout. Puerto Rican scholar Luis Cámara Fuertes wrote a wonderful book where he argued that in Puerto Rico, elections were a form of a spectacle. It was like a sport, it's a celebration, it's a carnival. And this celebration, this party, literally, people host major parties, not just at the national, well, not just in the metropolitan area, throughout the entire archipelago. Elections are a party. And this moved people to vote. And this voter turnout supported these major parties. Over time, however, we no longer see the celebration and there's a decline in voter turnout, another debate that we could come back to in the Q&A. But these two parties have been held up in part because of patronage networks. This has been very well documented. So Puerto Rico has a big government, a big public sector, and jobs in Puerto Rico are usually in the Puerto Rican government are often given to folks who support the ruling party. And this is one of the things that feeds back into their power, is their ability to give jobs to people. as well as the collapse of organizing structures within the left and independence movement, which were an opposition and a countervailing force to these major parties. As those organizing structures collapsed and they were repressed, they didn't collapse in some kind of vacuum. This is the result of repression. And also in a sense, a loss of touch with the energies on the ground, the issues that affected folks. So in the mid 2000s, Puerto Rico loses some of its tax incentives that propped up its economy, in particular its pharmaceutical industry. And austerity was forwarded as the main reaction to this loss of incentives. And there was no plan for economic development beyond tourism, which doesn't leave much money in the island to promote a local economy. So this prompts up a lot of organizing in the utilities sector and also in the educational sector, the student movement, for instance, which breathes new energies into the Puerto Rican political landscape. And we start seeing the emergence of new players, new actors in the field of politics in Puerto Rico, new organizations that are now more interested in the question, in questions that are at the intersection of class issues. So how people experience their lives economically, as well as race and gender, sexuality. And they're bringing in new energies, new issues, new ideas into the political landscape that are now being reflected in the composition of our legislature and our government because of the formation of new political parties like the Movimiento Victoria Ciudadana, a left-leaning party in Puerto Rico, and the resurgence of the Partido Independentista Puertorriqueño, the Independence Party. Although this is not all in favor of the left and progressive forces, because there's also been the emergence of a new religious fundamentalist party, the Partido Dignidad. So we are really witnessing an interesting moment for Puerto Rican politics, where we have new players in the scene that are garnering new energies and that are eroding the trust and support for longstanding majority parties like the pro-statehood party and the party that supports the current status. What will happen in the next few electoral cycles? It will be really interesting to observe. And I write a little bit about that in some columns in the Washington Post. And I am excited to see what will happen, whether Puerto Ricans will break with this bipartisan rule or whether these parties still have enough of a push and a pull in the local party structures that they've organized over time to preserve their power. So I will leave it there, and I'm excited to engage with you all in the Q&A session.
All right, thank you, Fernando. I have so many questions. I'm following you and Omar that I'm really excited to discuss. But before we get there, Luimil is going to talk more about cultural identity, political identity. I'm not going to try and explain it because she's going to, but I'm going to pass the mic to her now.
Well, I really wanted to thank you all very much and hope that everyone's having a fantastic morning or a fantastic afternoon, depending on where you are. I feel very honored today to be able to introduce Puerto Rican culture to you, or to kind of introduce it in a new and different way. When we hear from anthropologists talk about culture, they often say that culture is everything. Culture is how we dress, is how we talk, is how we eat. But not only that, it's how we engage in schools, how we engage at work. It's also how we engage with the political system. Which is why when I was told to talk about this today, I was really excited, but I was also very scared, because I was like, this is so overwhelming. How do you describe the complexity of a culture that was created and recreated through conquest, slavery, colonialism, hurricanes, earthquakes, famines, pandemics, you name it? How do you describe all of that in 10 minutes? Anyway, I decided to do a little magic trick, which is to start talking about a specific special persona in Puerto Rican culture. And I hope somebody has my first slide so I can show you who this person is. Maybe not,
Lindsay or Josh, can we pull up that slide?
I'll do a little dance while we wait. If not, it's okay. If not, the person who I was going to talk about today is the Puerto Rican jíbaro. Now the jíbaro, he is a country peasant. He's usually shown with a straw hat. He is usually shown in shabby clothes, barefoot, sometimes carrying plantains, but he is usually seen as also a white man. And this is a very, very interesting idea of how did this person become the symbol. Someone else story. The jíbaro was not always considered a good impostor. The descendant of natives and Africans. So in a way, in Mexico, he was considered the lowest strata class. While in Cuba, the jíbaro was considered an adjective. And he was here to describe, the next slide. He was here to, he described wild animals, like packs of wild dogs. So this is who the jíbaro was. In Latin America, a very negative figure. Similarly, in Puerto Rico in the 19th and 20th century, the jíbaro was considered a problem. He was seen as ridiculously dressed. He was overly religious. He was sickly and also promiscuous. Now, why did they describe it this way? What was happening in the world in Puerto Rico at the time? Well, I mean, we had hurricanes that destroyed crops. We had an American invasion, which severely impacted the Puerto Rican economy. So he was almost like a scapegoat for what was happening in the island. However, I will say that this negative view of the jíbaro changed in the 1930s. And a lot of that is really connected to what was happening in Puerto Rico at that time. We didn't really delve into this earlier, but in Puerto Rico in the 1930s, there was a lot of US oppression. English was considered the language in school, so Spanish was banned. There were protests that turned very violent. In fact, there's one that is called the Ponce Massacre, because 19 Puerto Ricans in 1937 were killed by the US supported cops and 200 were wounded. So the Puerto Rican intelligentsia, using the social and racial attitudes that prevailed Puerto Rican upper classes, reimagined this jíbaro that you see here as a hero against American oppression. He was now then strong, self-sufficient, but he was also a white male. Now, one of the leading figures of the 1930s, 40s, 50s, 60s, and even to this day, is Luis Muñoz Marín, who was the founder of the PPD, which Fernando talked about, the Partido Popular Democrático. He himself saw the life of the idealized jíbaro as simple and closer to the correct values which Puerto Ricans should strive. And next slide, please. This is the insignia of the Partido Popular Democrático. And as you see, it is a man who is in his profile and he's wearing that big straw hat. So he is a jíbaro. As the PPD began to grow, there grew a need to understand Puerto Rican history and character in the context of colonialism, especially as his party began to move away from independence. A huge question prevailed. How do we define Puerto Rican identity that at the end was subordinate to the United States? How do you define a nation without calling it a nation? Because a nation implies independence and, you know, he wasn't really into that. The Institute of Puerto Rican Culture, which is, I show the building in the next slide, was created in 1955 to answer these questions. It evaded, however, colonialism but also try to reconcile conflicts of race and class. Now, how did it do this? It kind of erased it. The cultural narrative changed from being narrative of conquest, slavery, and exploitation and resistance of the Jíbaro to one of harmony between the Taino, Spanish, and African traditions. In a way, the Jíbaro became a passive figure. Now, what effect did this have in our culture? I mean, we still grapple with these issues. In her fabulously titled chapter, From None of the Above, a book by, I think, Negrón-Montaner is her last name. In this chapter, Will the Real Puerto Rican Culture Please Stand Up? Raquel Zeta Rivera argues that the stories of African descendants were compressed and folklorized due to the institutionalization of Puerto Rican culture and the Jíbaro as the standard. Next slide, please. So Afro-Puerto Rican culture became more about bomba y plena and less about cimarrones. Bomba y plena, by the way, is a dance that is common in Afro communities in the island. Now, one of the ways that this was, this whole amazing tradition was compressed was that, you know, originally, bomba was danced in all parts of Puerto Rico. And in all these different parts, it had a different character. For example, in Mayagüez, it was usually danced by men. It wasn't danced by women. There's traditional rhythms that are done in different places. The institutionalization of the Jíbaro and also of this way of looking at culture kind of erased that. Erased the differences, made Loíza kind of the only point where this takes place. It also gained bomba its outfits. I mean, and we see in this picture, this lovely little kids dressed in white with the turbans. And I mean, these outfits are fabulous, but actually bomba originally was danced with street clothes. People just went in, you know, usually when their time off from doing their labor to dance and to get together. And for a while, it stopped being really about the people. It started just being a show. Also, one thing that was completely ignored by this institutionalization of culture, it's such a weird word to say, was the fact that Puerto Ricans is an urban society. 95% of Puerto Ricans live in urban environments. Most of, in like, I think over half now, live in the United States. So what happens to these people? Now, so what does this Jíbaro persona, what is he now? It is important to consider and to know that the Jíbaro is still a very important figure in Puerto Rican culture. When you go to Christmases, you see him everywhere. You see his music everywhere, and it's absolutely gorgeous. I mean, I'm not dissing it at all. He's also central to what you will see in my next slide, which is La Semana de la Puertorriqueñidad, where students all over the island, they dress usually as Jíbaros to represent what being Puerto Rican is. However, in popular culture, he's seen as something different. And I'm using here the term referent because urban artists, singers, painters, they all use the Jíbaro, but some of it in a different way. For example, I think one of the articles that I was reading, it talked about how the Jíbaro, like this rapper, his name is Eddie, he was rejecting the Jíbaro. He was like, I have nothing, this person has nothing in common with me. I have more in common with the culture of rap in the United States than I do with this guy. However, you also have artists like Mima, which I think I sent out a link so that your homework is going to be to check her out. She uses Jíbaro music as a reference in the last single that she created, fusing synthesizers, electric guitars, which the style of the jíbaro. So that's kind of where we have it. I mean, the jíbaro is vibrant, but so are all these different forms of culture. We have reggaeton, we have, and even in the paintings, like for example, you know, I showed one of the slides is this painting of this man, the jíbaro, the standard jíbaro using, carrying a bouquet of plantains. There is a visual artist who does a very similar picture called the same thing, El Pan Nuestro. And it's of a naked woman holding the plantains. So it is used as a reference. It is, people kind of play with it, but it's not necessarily what we are all about because we are a culture that is always changing. So anyway, thank you so much. That is the end of my presentation.
No, thank you, Luimil. And I think you lead us right into our first question for all you panelists. You know, why don't we start with you, Luimil? I'm curious to find out for you all, how has this status, you know, affected your identity as Puerto Rican? I mean, Omar started out and he's got it in his background, you know, yo soy boricua pa que tu sepas, you know, I mean, so there is, obviously we are all here because we identify and, you know, care about what's happening, but I'm curious to learn more about how this, you know, the current state of things has affected how you view yourself.
That's a very good question. However, I have to say that I was completely born into that. You know, I don't know any different I don't know what it's like to be in a culture where, for example, there's just a nation and that's it. You know, I remember being a little kid and going to marches. My dad is pro-independent and we would have our flag out. And actually I have his flag right in front of me. I remember, you know, a huge part of my life was going to elections and to have that, I mean, even as a little kid, 3-4 years old, to know, hey, this is what this party means. This party is the party of statehood, you know, and you know these things from when you're a little kid. Besides, I think it's given me a ferocity to know about Puerto Rican politics. And it's funny because, you know, I've lived a lot of my time in Puerto Rico, but a lot of time I've lived out in the United States. And when I was growing up, we received the paper and we talked about the plebiscites, you know, even though we weren't voting in it. So maybe it has actually, what it has made me is very conscious of these questions and of these issues from the time I was, you know, before I could walk. And that's something that other people maybe in other countries don't have.
No, thank you. And I just want to just clarify for the crowd, the plebiscites are the various votes on statehood. And I know those are, that's not even a simple question, but just to clarify for folks who might know what we're talking about. But I want to go to Omar next. You had your virtual hand up and then we'll go to Fernando.
I didn't mean to raise my hand that way. I'm sorry. I must have done that inadvertently, but
I want to hear from all of you anyway. So I mean,
but yeah, you know, as a diasporican, you know, I was not born on the island. I was born in D.C., raised in Silver Spring, Maryland, and this has always been a point of confusion, right? Because the idea that the island has changed sovereignties, two different sovereignties, over the last 500 plus years, which at this point essentially has erased anything that happened before then, is in itself confusing. And of course, because we live in a society that perpetuates xenophobia in ways that are very unhealthy and dangerous, then, you know, we're always, even though we have this citizenship and we're part of this, you know, American empire, I mean, we're still denied that connection, even though that connection itself is problematic, right? And so where you have people who may occupy different elected offices, not even really fully understanding who we are as an island, and much less what it looks like in a diaspora. You know, one of the things I always linked into was there's something that's called the El Puerto Rican Embassy that was started by the New York Rican Poets Cafe by Dalma Maldonado, who recently passed away. Folks like Pedro Pietri, who passed away years ago, and Mariposa Fernandez, who's a poet. And the idea, and I latch on to that a lot more, because the idea of that is that you are really connecting to a state of Puerto Rico, and understand like an emotional state, a cultural state, and that state essentially becomes your nation. And so they even developed these passports that you could buy, and you could put your face in it. You can basically fill it out. You would, like, in the way that you would a passport that you would receive from the United States. And so for me, those type of connections are much more meaningful than it is to try to make any connection to this existing craziness and confusion of what it is to be Puerto Rican, what it is to be part of this this colonial empire that the United States has developed over the years of its existence.
A great question. And I remember as a child, one of my earliest political memories was my grandfather once saw me really excited watching the TV, and it was a big political rally. And out of nowhere, he asked me, "Fernando, are you a patriot?" And I didn't know what to say. I was a kid. But I never forgot that question. And it really shaped how I thought about what am I a patriot of, or to whom do I have loyalties, right? And it really centered around this question of, which is my country? Am I a Puerto Rican patriot that is loyal to a Puerto Rican nation that represents a Puerto Rican culture and a Puerto Rican people? Is there such a thing, right? Is that an identity? Or I'm a patriot of our actual sovereign of the United States? Is there such a thing as a multiracial democracy in the United States that has a space for us, for those who were not in the room when they drafted the Constitution? And it shaped my political identity, and it led me to question my identity more generally beyond politics. And I think over time, questioning that recurrently shaped my interest in becoming a political scientist and to devoting a life entirely to understanding questions of this nature. And I think that not just for us individually, but also for people who identify as Puerto Ricans, they have strong feelings about politics. And I think it in part is because of this status question, that it defines them, that they feel compelled to define themselves. I remember as a kid going to barbershops, and it said, "Here we do not talk religion or politics." And I think that, sometimes that must have been a result of the heated conversations that talking politics can, in Puerto Rico, can lead to. So not just individually, but collectively, I think that the whole question of the status shapes how Puerto Ricans see themselves in relation to others, and not just politically, but also in terms of their ethnic and racial identity as well.
No, and this is so fascinating to hear from all of you, because I've never heard diasporican before. I always call myself a Misurican or a Misurikenya, because I was born and raised in St. Louis and didn't have any of these experiences, and that could be a whole other conversation. But it's so interesting to hear it as this cultural state of mind and to hear all your experiences. So I want to kind of ask the next question. I want to flip it in some ways, because there is a statistic that came out in 2017 with Hurricane Maria that nearly half of people in the US didn't know that Puerto Ricans were American citizens or citizens of the US. So in this, you know, and Missouri is a place where, you know, there isn't the same kind of the same amount of Puerto Ricans as, you know, New York, or there's not a Missouri Rican Poets Cafe, but maybe we could start one for the people out there. But what are for folks who haven't had the same experience or been questioning, you know, been wrestling with this question of identity, what do you want people who don't know much about the culture or the island or the history, what are some things you would want them to know or to take away from this conversation?
I think one thing that I always like to think about is that culture is not static. Culture changes. And it is like a mad sancocho. You know, people from the diaspora, we bring a different energy. Like the mind is a sovereign nation. Who came up with that? Those were the New York Rican Cafe guys, which I'll never, it's actually one of my mottos in life. It's an evolving thing. But we are also very attached to it. Like I found this book, this cooking book, actually it's one of the cooking books that I use, Coconuts and Colors. It's a mixture of Southern cooking with Puerto Rican cooking. Like who would have thought of something that cool? Like, I mean, it's vibrant. And Puerto Rican, I mean, there's a culture now that has evolved around protests. You know, there are all these things that are happening and that are, I mean, man, we like as a nation or as a territory, whatever you wanna call it, we've been dealing with a lot and yet, our heritage is to push forward and to create. And I think that's like super fabulous. I love being Puerto Rican. I'm just gonna add that to the record. So it's formally put somewhere.
I would never be able to tell you that you didn't like being Puerto Rican, Luimil. I'm shocked. That's wonderful. I mean, I think for me, the biggest myth that I would like to exploit is the idea of a racial democracy. I think this racial democracy has been problematic and it just spins off into many other false propositions that even we as a Puerto Rican community writ large, whether we're on the island or different parts of the diaspora, have continued to perpetuate and really have compromised the ability for us to build coalition around.
Can you explain a little bit more what you mean by that?
Sure. So a racial democracy is this idea that in Puerto Rico and ultimately anybody who comes from that in the diaspora believes that our history and our culture has promoted an equity amongst races that does not exist, usually compared to the United States, which everybody acknowledges has this racist history. And so, but because Puerto Rico is different, people have implied and inferred based on false propositions that idea is not something that exists on the island. And those are things that we have learned as a result of our contact, either on the island through the sovereignty of the United States, or for us who've actually were born and raised or moved to the United States. And that is false. I mean, it's a false notion. And it really sheds light when you see things like, you know, people getting arrested by police on the island that are racially motivated arrests. There's rules where they don't allow certain people of certain hues in certain parts of the island or certain clubs. And those things are policed by the state there, just in the same way they're policed by the state here in the mainland of the United States. And, you know, one of the things that really brought it to home, and I think this is an applicable statement to the island and to the diaspora, is there's a professor, African-American professor by the name of Hassan Jeffries at Ohio State University. What he said was a multiracial democracy is the biggest barrier to white supremacy, but white supremacy is also the biggest barrier to multiracial democracy. those things are reciprocal. Those things are in relationship with one another. And until we understand that we deal with the racism on the island, as well as the racism that has already reached out to the diasporan communities, we're always going to stand on this false idea of a racial democracy. One of the wonderful things that's happened on the island is two good friends, my sisters in the struggle, Dr. Mayra Santos Febres and Dr. Marielba Torres, have gotten $700,000 from the Mellon Foundation to establish the very first Department of Africana Studies at UPI, University of Puerto Rico de Piedras, the flagship campus, the alma mater of my mother. You know, this is huge, right? But it's also a little sad. 2021? Like in 2021, we come up with an Africana Studies department? You know, I mean, after like African people being there for 600 years? Like, it, you know, so this is where we're at. But now you see a movement. Now you see the same activists that were protesting against Rosello are the same activists that started Black Lives Matter Puerto Rico chapter, right? So you see a through line now. And so now that you see this through line, people are starting to become more aware. And now historians, anthropologists, political scientists, now we can kind of start to fill in those gaps like we have today with Fernando and Luimil, to help people understand and have a better understanding of what it is to be Puerto Rican, what that means for today and the future.
Thank you, Omar and Luimil. Amazing, amazing insights. I would say I debate very, very recurrently whether I have any hope for folks gaining a better understanding of Puerto Rico. Some days I do feel hopeful, some days I'm more cynical. What I do like to tell folks is that whatever is done with Puerto Rico or whatever Puerto Ricans choose to do, should not be, particularly around the question of status, which shapes so much in Puerto Rico, should not be because it will give some party an advantage over the other, or it will give a particular elite an advantage over others. I really believe that the resolution of Puerto Ricans' problems should be in the hands of an inclusive notion of who Puerto Ricans are. And that is not just those who remain in Puerto Rico, but also those who, by virtue of many different forces, many of which were not up to them, are now residing in the mainland United States. And I think that would break with what I observe is the dominant reason for why folks consider extending to Puerto Ricans some sense of justice, whether that is through statehood or other kinds of social policies, which is that it will give a particular party a certain advantage over the other. I don't think those were the reasons for why we should address justice. Justice should have should be an end in itself, not a means towards some person, some group's supremacy over others.
Wow. So we've got just probably less than a minute left. I just want to open it up to you all. And is there any final closing thoughts that you want? I know we did a whole history in like an hour, but are there any final thoughts for the audience that you want to, that you'd like to say? Okay, so I'm going to end us on time. But with that, it's been un placer. You all have filled my heart, really. I was trying to hold back some emotions, such pride, but such really insightful, amazing perspectives and conversation. And just thank you all for joining us here and thinking about in Missouri, or, you know, virtually, but here for our audience here, and really just, you know, sharing, you know, not just your knowledge, but your heart. Thank you. And I will do the final plug for the presentation. Today's presentation will be recorded, so please share it with others. It should be on the Missouri Historical Society's YouTube by Thursday. So share it, and thank you again.
Thank you.